thank you very much for the opportunity to discuss with you some of the details of the experimental work that we're doing in my group, or actually have been doing over many years now. And since early 2014, we are in the Technical University of Delft. So I don't know if you've been to the Netherlands, but there's not only Amsterdam, there's also The Hague and Rotterdam, and right in between there's this small old town called Delft. And that's where one of our three technical universities are. And since 2010, there's a brand new department in this university. It's called the Department of Bionanoscience. And this is where we collect groups with a background in single molecule biophysics, nanotechnology, and synthetic biology, cell biology, to really make a multidisciplinary group of researchers. And associated with this department at the university is also a program, a bachelor and a master program in what we call nanobiology. And it's really a mix between physics, mathematics, and biology. So it's very close, probably also to your hearts. So that's where we are. This is the group of people that is currently in my group. So there's PhD students, PhD students, postdocs, and technicians. Most of them shared with other labs, and they have different backgrounds. Some were have a background in physics, and some in biology. None of them yet in nanobiology. I have to still wait a few more years to get these mixed people in the lab. And the work I'm going to be talking about, although is a long story, so we're interested, as I will show you, in how cytoskeletal systems self-organize in cells and how this helps cells to do things like divide or polarize themselves or move. And we're using reconstitution bottom-up techniques to build these systems, starting at the molecular level, as a way to understand, hopefully, how they also work in cells. So I'll start from the beginning, from the early work, and sort of talk you through one of these projects to the stage where we are now, which means that a lot of what I will show is also due to people that were previously in my lab, and there's three names here that were there most recently. And I've highlighted Matthijs Vleugel's name and Sophie Rood, so they are postdocs in my group. And most of the current work that I will show you, and that's also on this first slide, is actually their work. So what we're interested eventually is understanding how a dynamic force generation microtubule cytoskeleton is able to build this. And the way we're trying to understand that, of one of the ways, is to build this. So this is a very naive, minimalistic version of a mitotic spindle that we build from a limited number of components in artificial confinement in microfluidic droplets. And this is sort of where we are right now, I'll tell you how we got there. So by the way, what I will do is talk about, you know, experimental techniques that we use, a little bit of the details of how we do that. If you have questions, you can stop me. I have an hour, but you know, I will talk for an hour if you want, but I can also show a lot less if you ask me questions, which would be more fun. So as just a background, what is our group interested in general? Like I said already, every eukaryotic cell, like actually also prokaryotic cells, so like bacteria, have a cytoskeletal network, a network of polymer or protein, self-assembled protein polymers or filaments that allows them to organize their interior, to move, to take a certain shape, to change shape. And we're interested in how, and we've been mostly working on the microtubule cytoskeleton, uses its dynamic properties and the forces that it can generate. And I will show you experiments that we use to measure these forces to help organize the interior of cells. Now, we are focused very much on the mechanical aspects of this, rigidity, forces that are generated. But of course, to make a cell do anything is very important. There's also very tight biochemical regulation that monitors all these mechanical processes. And I will not talk about that at all today, although it's at least, or maybe even more interesting, if you want to understand how cells use the cytoskeleton to do things. So the microtubule cytoskeleton in particular, there's several things it can do. So this is a sort of a classical, almost textbook example of a cell going through cell division. And what you see here is a movie taken by, I think, a microscope manufacturer. It's not taken by us, where you see in a red the chromosomes, which have been labeled with a red dye, have been duplicated, that have been condensed into chromosomes, and that need to be divided between two new daughter cells. And in green, you see the mitotic spindle. It's the collection of microtubule polymers that self-organizes first to put the chromosomes in the middle of the cell and then eventually pull them apart such that each daughter cell ends up with the exact same number of chromosomes as its sister cell. So we're interested not only in how microtubules help organize the mitotic spindle, we're also very much interested in this problem. So this is now a simple eukaryotic cell. It's a fission yeast cell. It's not the well-known budding yeast, but the fission yeast, which is a very symmetrical, simple, small, elongated cell. And when this cell is growing, so it's not during cell division, but it's actually during interphase when the cell is not dividing, but just increasing twice in size, it does so by growing in an elongated fashion. So the width of this cell doesn't increase. It's only the length that grows twice as long. And when this cell is done growing twice as long, it will divide in the middle. So the microtubule cytoskeleton in that case is responsible, I will show you in a later movie, for several things. It's keeping the nucleus in the middle of the cell. You don't see it here, but again, I'll show you in a later movie. The microtubules are hooked up to the membrane of the nucleus, and they grow towards the cell ends. And by reaching the cell ends and bumping into the cell ends, they exert forces which are transmitted to the nuclear membrane, keeping the nucleus nicely positioned in the middle where it needs to be once cell division takes place after the cell has grown twice its length. But at the same time, the cytoskeleton is used to polarize the cell. And when I say polarize the cell, I mean that biochemically, the cell ends are different from the cell sides to make sure that cell growth happens only at the cell ends. So the actin machinery that is responsible for bringing cellular material to the cell ends is recruited by these green molecules. They're just found at the cell ends. The name of this particular one is T2. It doesn't really matter. There's also others. And it's the microtubule cytoskeleton that is responsible for keeping this distribution of these molecules asymmetric, like you see in this movie. So what happens in detail is that dynamic filaments that grow towards the cell ends, they carry at their growing end some of these molecules. You see it in this movie here, where only the end-tracking proteins, as they are called, are highlighted. And when they reach the cell ends, they get preferentially deposited somehow at the membrane. There's receptor molecules there. And this somehow keeps this polarized distribution of cell end markers alive and in good shape. And this is how the cell knows to grow at its cell end. So it's both keeping performing a mechanical function, keeping the nucleus in the middle, and an organizational function, sort of in organizing intracellular space to know where cell growth has to take place. And if you disrupt the microtubule cytoskeleton, not only does the nucleus lose its position, but also the cell starts to grow in funny shapes, in particular T shapes, which is why this molecule has been termed T1. So we're, in addition to just different examples of how microtubules organize the interior of cells, we're also starting to be interested in looking at how actin and microtubule cytoskeletal systems crosstalk with each other. So there's a whole parallel universe where biophysicists study the actin cytoskeleton, but of course in the cell, these cytoskeletal systems communicate with each other. And one example, again, these are all pictures that motivate us. None of them, except for the fission yeast, are taken by us. But it's what gives us the inspiration for our in vitro experiments. And this particular one is showing a motile cell. It's taken by the lab of Elaine Fuchs. It's a paper from several years ago, where you see in blue actin cables that are attached to focal adhesions here in pink, and this cell is crawling on a surface, on a flat substrate. And in green, you see similar end-tracking proteins that travel, live at the ends of growing microtubules, just like you saw here. And they are guided by actin cables to these focal adhesions. So the actin network is helping the microtubule, or is helping to orient the microtubule growth towards these focal adhesions, where they are believed to help the turnover of focal adhesions. So if there's no correct crosstalk between actin and microtubules in this system, then microtubules will not find their way to the focal adhesions. You get overdeveloped focal adhesions that make the cells stick permanently to the cell. So how the sort of mechanically interaction between these two systems works is also something that we started to be interested in. And I do this in a collaboration with the group of Gijsje Koenderink, who is in Amsterdam and is a biophysicist working on the actin cytoskeleton. So in all these cases, we never, almost never study live cells ourselves, although we collaborate constantly with cell biologists. But we try to approach we try to contribute to understanding these systems by building them, like I said, from the bottom up. So this is the picture I already showed you, and I'll spend most of the time talking about, where we try to build, using minimal components in droplets, minimal version of spindles. But we're trying to do the same thing also for this polarity system. So what you can do is make either microfabricated chambers or microfluidic droplets that have the shape of cells, confine dynamic microtubules in this in these shapes, and actually try to build up what is minimally required to get a polarized microfabricated chamber, for example, in a way to understand how this happens in a real cell. And the same approach we also use for the actin microtubule crosstalk, so we can engineer molecules that allow microtubules to interact with actin filaments in vitro, and then show that an ester of microtubules, by allowing it to interact with actin filaments, can actually also organize actin filaments in the way that is dictated by the microtubule. So this is just a glimpse. I will not spend too much time on these two projects unless there's extra time in the end, or you ask me afterwards. Okay, I'm going to take a giant step back just to the textbooks and just give you some basic information about the microtubule cytoskeleton. So some of this is known since the early 80s when Mark Kirschner and Tim Mitchison, they discovered that microtubules are very dynamic polymers that constantly switch between phases of growth and shrinkage in a process that they termed dynamic instability. So at the risk of telling you something you've known for a long time already, this is the textbook picture of what a single microtubule looks like. It's the basic component of both this spindle and this yeast system and the other examples that I showed you. It's a hollow tube of about 25 nanometer in diameter, and it grows spontaneously in the cell, but also if you purify this protein away from the cell, by assembling tubulin subunits at a certain rate. And it's important that these tubulin subunits are associated with molecules of GTP, an energy-carrying molecule, and it's only in that, in associated with GTP, that these filaments will spontaneously form. And then upon formation of these hollow tubes, internally the GTP gets hydrolyzed. It's symbolized here with turning from black to white. And then white microtubules, GDP-associated microtubules, are not intrinsically stable. So as soon as there's a structure here at the end, a stabilizing structure called the gap, when that's lost, a growing filament will spontaneously switch to a shrinking filament. And even though we've known about this process for more than 30 years now, it's still not really well understood how on a molecular level that switching between growing and shrinking states occurs, even though we know a lot more now. But you can see it happen very nicely in a real cell. So this is again the fishing yeast, and you see individual filaments, microtubules that are nucleated here at some anti-parallel overlap zone, grow towards the cell ends, and then in each individual one can at some random point in time switch from a growing phase to a sinking phase. So the switching is a random process. It depends on other molecules that are around. It depends on in vitro on temperature and concentration of tubulin, but it's an inherently spontaneous or a random process. Now, we are interested in the forces that have been developing experiments, understanding and measuring the forces that these filaments can generate. So an individual microtubule, when it grows, it can actually, if you put it in front of some object, can generate a pushing force. And it can transmit this force to the motion of a chromosome, for example, because the filament is relatively stiff. But also the shrinking filament, assuming that it's hooked up somehow to a cargo that it's trying to pull on, can also generate a pulling force. And it's quite clear from this fission yeast movie that the pushing of microtubules against the cell ends is actually contributing to the positioning of this nucleus. So I think I'll come to it later. Have a movie where you see this much better, taken by Fong, who was sitting in the back there when he was a postdoc in Cheng's lab. So, but for the moment, you have to believe me that there's a nucleus here, and it's by the growth of these filaments that pushing forces can be generated, and that contribute to the or define the position of the nucleus in the cell. Shrinking forces are also been for a long time been known to be involved, for example, in the motion of chromosomes. So dynamic microtubule ends hook up to chromosomes during cell division, where they both generate pushing and pulling forces depending on where the chromosomes are going. So we've started a long time to just look at how forces are generated at the single microtubule level. So this is the kind of experiments that we developed. So you can make artificial barriers just by going to the clean room and making glass walls. This is the sort of the early ways in which we did that. And then you can take a single microtubule, hook it up to the glass of a cover slip, and watch a single growing filament bump into such a glass wall. And this is now a looping movie, so you only see the growth of this filament. And then from the bending behavior, so it's stuck here, it runs into a fixed wall there, and just by continuing to assemble subunits at its growing end, it's elongating, generating a force, and as a result of the force, the filament buckles. And you can do very classical analysis, bending analysis of these filaments to deduce what is the force being generated here at the growing filament. I'm not showing you these data, you can all look it up, but forces of several piconewtons are generated. And what's also important or interesting to us is that these forces then affect the dynamic properties of the filament. So as soon as you put a force here at the end, the filament will grow less quickly, obviously, because it's now performing work. And it's, this is at the cost of assembling new subunits. And it will also switch more often to a shrinking state. So as soon as a microtubule bumps into an object, it slows down and it will become way more likely to switch to a shrinking state, which is actually relevant for the fission yeast example, where the switching between growing and shrinking phases happens always at the cell end. So as soon as you reach the cell end, you feel a compressive force, and then the microtubules start to shrink again. And on average, this is an efficient way of keeping the nucleus in the middle. So we can also use laser tweezer techniques. So instead of sticking this seed to the surface of a cover slip, we can stick it to a small bead. And then we use what we call a keyhole trap, where we trap the bead in an optical tweezer, and we trap also this nucleating structure oriented towards a barrier. And then when the filament grows, it pushes against the wall. In this particular movie, we're moving the wall, but normally we keep the wall steady. And then we can watch the bead being pushed out of the trap by the growth of this filament, and as an alternative way of measuring the forces. And like I said, we can then compare the response of the filament assembly to the applied forces to what you see happening in a fission yeast cell when the microtubules reach the cell end. So that's about, yes, thank you. I can maybe draw you this data. What happens is that if you plot here the velocity of the polymer and you plot here the force that is applied at its growing end, if you do not have a force, you just have a velocity that you can measure in experiments like this. It's maybe in vitro conditions 1.5 micrometer per minute. And then as you apply a force, the velocity will go down. And the typical forces, let's say, are on the order of 5 piconewton here. So as you slow down, the probability to switch from a growing to a shrinking state goes up. So there's not a threshold force, there's just an overall reduction of the growth velocity, and then there's a probability associated with that growth velocity for having a catastrophe. And that roughly looks like this. So if you plot on this axis the velocity of growth, the same thing as here, and you plot on this axis the time it takes on average to undergo a catastrophe, then if the velocity is high, no force, you get a certain time. And for under these conditions, it's several minutes. So on average, once every several minutes, there will be a catastrophe. But again, if you look at the events, it's exponentially distributed, more or less. So it's really a random process. And as you now increase the force, you lower the velocity. And then if, you know, more or less extrapolated, this data looks like this. So you go to lower and lower average catastrophe times. And then there's a special situation where the growth is zero. This is, we call that the stall force. So somewhere there's a stall force here, although we don't really know exactly where it is. But if you apply a very high force, then the filament will stop growing. And then there's a sort of a minimal time it will take until a catastrophe, which is on the order of 20 or 30 seconds. So that's roughly what we know. And maybe the last thing to say about it, in this experiment, what determines the force is the critical buckling force. So if you have a wall and a microtubule that is trying to grow against this wall and it's stuck here, then there's a critical length below which this buckling cannot happen. Which is related to the length of the 1/length of this filament squared. So very short filaments that just come and stop, because you would need a critical high force to buckle them, which brings you somewhere here on this curve, and they simply do not grow. Yes?
Here you grow the catastrophe rate, you grow the catastrophe rate correlated with the velocity.
Yes.
Could also be correlated with the force, but you have ways to change the velocity by applying force to check.
Yes, yeah, great. So it's all in 10-year-old now, JCB 2006 paper. 2003 JCB paper. So those were the first measurements we did. So you can change the velocity by applying a force, but you can also simply change the concentration of tubulin. And you lower the tubulin concentration and you go down the same line. And actually, we plotted it this way because the whole point at the time was to show that all the force does is reduce the velocity at which it grows, and that then determines the catastrophe rate and nothing intrinsically different. Even though, if you look at the data, if let's say that these are the ones, the concentration ones, so we can go down to a certain, velocity. If you go very much down in concentration, you get so many catastrophes you cannot measure anymore, so this is limited. And then we can do the same thing with force, and we get a few more data points at lower velocities, because we can really go to slow velocities. And you know, whether they're really on one line, or maybe one is like this and one is like that, I have the idea that there is actually a little bit of difference between the two data sets in this area, but we don't have enough to really make big claims. So far, we sort of assume that they're on the same line, and you change. And one extra thing is that what this means is that the velocity of polymerization, now I'm getting into a lot of textbook details, but I think that's good. Very roughly speaking, is a balance between on rate and off rate. Yeah, so the velocity of polymerization in the end will be some length scale, let's call it delta, and then there's a rate at which they attach minus a rate at which they detach, and that gives you the average growth velocity. Of course, you have to take into account that there's 13 protofilaments and not just one, so it all gets more complicated, but basically this is it. And the growth velocity, this on rate, is actually linearly dependent on the concentration of tubulin. And when you change the tubulin concentration, you reduce the on rate. And when you apply a force, we think you also, all you do is reduce the on rate. You simply allow less space between a fluctuating filament and an object for new things to insert, and you're reducing the on rate just like you do by lowering the tubulin concentration. And the effect on the catastrophe rate is more or less the same as far as we can measure. Other questions? Okay, let me. And then these were pushing force experiments. We were also interested in being able to measure pulling forces, and that's a bit more involved. So the fact that pulling forces can, that shrinking filaments can generate pulling forces, had also been demonstrated by the groups of Dick McIntosh in Boulder and also Chip Ashbury, who put beads at the ends of shrinking filaments and then showed beads coated with some molecule that will attach to the lattice of a microtubule, and they could show that when this filament starts to shrink, it will pull the bead along for a short moment of time. So this is already showing that shrinking filaments can generate force. And not only is that important for pulling chromosomes apart during cell division, but for example, this C. elegans embryo here, it's a first cell stage C. elegans embryo. It's a picture taken by Stefan Grill when he was in Tony Hyman's lab. And this spindle here is positioning itself, again, with respect to the boundary of this confined cell. A little bit, you might think, as this system where the microtubules are keeping the nucleus in the middle. But unlike the fission yeast, where only pushing forces seem to be needed to keep this thing in the middle, the spindle needs pulling forces to be generated here at the periphery. So what Stefan showed is that if you cut microtubules on one end, then this whole structure, the centrosome with all the microtubules, will be pulled towards the cortex, sort of indicating that the interaction of dynamic filaments with the cortex here doesn't only generate pushing forces, but also pulling forces. And this is something that we wanted to reconstitute as well. So now what's also known from these and other experiments, that one of the ways you can link a shrinking filament to, for example, a cortex, but also to a kinetochore, to a chromosome, is by using a molecular motor. So these are just some cartoons of several situations in which this has been observed. So in budding yeast, but also in fission yeast during a different stage of the cell cycle. And in these C. elegans embryos, there's a cortical complex, and I draw sort of these white blobs as if they're not important. They're of course very important. These are molecules that regulate the activity of dynein or other molecular motors here at the cortex. So there are other molecules here, but the one that is eventually making a connection between the cortex and a dynamic filament end in these systems is a molecular motor called dynein. Now, dynein is one of the molecular motors that walks on microtubules towards its minus end, unlike kinesin, which walks towards a plus end. So what dynein would like to do is move along the microtubule lattice to the minus end towards the periphery. And you can imagine that if this motion of the motor is combined with a shrinkage, a shortening of the filament, and then you can generate a pulling force here and pull the centrosome towards the cortex. And that was sort of in words how we understood how pulling forces are generated in the C. elegans embryo. And it's due to this kind of interaction. So years after we measured the pushing forces, and there was a student in my lab, Lee de Weilaam, and she managed to reconstitute this end-on interaction between, you could say, an artificial cortex and a dynamic microtubule end, again using microfabrication techniques. So in this case, we have a barrier. In the previous experiments where you saw the growing filament buckling, it was just a glass, bare barrier. But now we made it of gold, and gold has the advantage that you can do gold-specific chemistry. And with the help of Samrek Petersen and Ron Vail, who had isolated and engineered biotinylated dynein molecular motor from budding yeast, we could specifically preferentially coat these gold barriers with molecular motors, keeping the rest of the sample free for many of these motors. And then we could put a nucleation center on the glass, in this case a centrosome, and let microtubules grow and interact with their dynamic end head-on with these walls. So we didn't want any sideways contacts so that you get gliding assays. We really wanted this dynamic end to hit the barrier and then interact there with a molecular motor, as it was assumed to be the case at the cortex of C. elegans embryos. So this is some details of all the nasty extra molecules we have to put to make it all stick correctly and to get enough motors attached, but this in the end works. And if you now look at what happens to microtubules that bump into such a barrier, this is now a different microscopy technique from what I showed you before. It's now just fluorescence, whereas before it was differential ear interference, but it doesn't really matter. So this, the centrosome is stuck here to the surface. Filaments are growing, and like this one here does, as we saw before, it hits the barrier and it bends, buckles a little bit, and is generating a pushing force. But most of them appear completely stabilized. So they're no longer growing, but they're also not shrinking. And as we just discussed, normally when a filament hits a barrier and the force is too high such that it stalls, it will take only 20 or 30 seconds to have a catastrophe, whereas these are completely stable. So we interpret this as the dyneing being able to grab the dynamic filament, stopping its growth, but also preventing its shrinkage. And we cannot really tell if it's now a stalled growing microtubule or a stalled shrinking microtubule, but we, when we did this experiment, thought, okay, it's quite likely that this dynein is now trying to pull on this filament, but the centrosome is stuck, so the whole system is stalled. And apparently a motor that is not able to walk will also no longer allow the filament to shrink, which was sort of a surprise. And then we redid this experiment, or Liedewij did together with Julien in an optical tweezer experiment. And again, I'm showing you the fancy picture version of it, just to give you an idea of how the experiment was designed. So that we take again a bead attached to this filament or a bundle of filaments and allow the dynamic end to interact with a wall that is covered with dynein molecular motors. And then we could show that the combination of a filament that is shrinking with a motor that is actively trying to walk in this direction is enough to generate or to make a pulling force generating machinery that generates forces on the order of several piconewton. So it's not perfect. For example, it generates forces for maybe 10, 20 seconds and then it lets go. Whereas in the cell, it's probably more robust. So there's other molecules, these white blobs that I showed you, that are probably important to keep it more robust. But you only need these two ingredients to make a pulling force machine. And it's also interesting that if you do not allow the filament to shrink because you keep the force on the bead very high or because you don't provide it with hydrolyzable GTP, then nothing will happen. If you don't provide the motor with ATP, it will just hang on to the filament and also prevent anything from happening. So you really need some kind of a coordination between a walking motor and a shrinking filament to generate these pulling forces. So, okay, that's all nice. Yes?
So in the last slide, you showed that the dynein can pull the microtubule. That's possibly because it's pulling on the microtubule and it stalls. But I don't know if by severing microtubule at that time by laser or something, is it possible for you to measure exactly if it's under tension?
Yeah, so that's a very good idea. We never did that experiment, but that would certainly what I would expect. So what I think, based on the optical tweezers experiments we did later and also some other information, is that these filaments are actually trying to shrink, but they are held back by dynein molecules that are attached to the shrinking ends. And we think here there's multiple dyneins because we did this at very high dynein concentration. If you lower the motor concentration on the wall, and you can do that, you will see that they stay in this situation for a limited amount of time. And at some point, the motors let go, and then it quickly disassembles. But here, where you have a very stable situation, there's probably multiple motors interacting. And what you could do is easily, actually, we never did it, take a laser and cut them, and you would for sure see that they shrink. Well, for sure, we didn't do it, but yeah. That's all consistent with also with the tweezer data that we did later. But it is interesting that if you have enough motors, they can together really prevent this shrinkage from happening and stall the shrinking process by interacting with the dynamic end. This is what this experiment shows. Other questions? Okay, but so we now know in quite a bit of detail what the forces that can be generated, how they affect the dynamics of both the motors and the filaments, but what we really wanted to know from the beginning is how are these forces involved in positioning structures or inside the cell or organizing the interior of cells. And these are the two examples that we were sort of putting side by side that I've already discussed three times now. And now here's the picture from Fong. It's showing really the fission yeast, again, now with the nucleus nicely marked. And you see that the individual microtubules that hit the cell ends here generate pushy forces. And you see the same buckling behavior, actually. We tried for a while to also analyze the bending behavior in these cells to measure directly the force as we did in vitro. But it was never really easy to do. The boundary conditions are too complicated. You get an order of magnitude, but we know the order of magnitude, and more detailed than that we never managed to get from this kind of analysis. But anyway, it's clear what you can do, for example, and this is what we did, is do the statistics of the catastrophes depending on whether a force is applied or not to these filaments, and then you really see the same hints that as soon as you put a high force, you get a low velocity and a fast catastrophe rate, very consistent with what we found also in the in vitro experiments. So it's quite well established that the positioning of this nucleus is really due to alternating pushing forces on the other ends. But as I explained, why then does this different cell, which has a different shape, a different size, maybe also a different task of positioning this spindle here, why does it not rely on pushing forces? Why does it rely on pulling forces? And independent of the why question, you can just ask, depending on the geometry and the combination of pushing and pulling forces that are generated, can we understand why these things end up nicely positioned in the middle? And what are the sort of the circumstances under which you would expect that to happen? So we did experiments like these, where it's not really yet a fission yeast cell or a C. elegans yeast shell in terms of shape and size, but for the moment the early experiment were just square boxes, sort of square microfabricated chambers in glass. So the experiments we did, this is an EM picture of an array of square chambers that we made in glass, 10, 20 micrometers a side and a few micrometers high. And then we would put a single centrosome radiating out microtubules in these chambers and just ask where does it go depending on the dynamic properties of the microtubules and depending on whether we put molecular motors on the sides or not. Because we can now again put gold rims, edges on these chambers. So just use a sandwich technique where we deposit glass or silicon monoxide, gold, and then silicon monoxide again, and then dig through these layers with ion etching or some wet etching, and you get chambers that have a side that has at least a rim of gold, and we put molecular motors again only specifically on the edges, creating an artificial cortex. And we could put many of them or few of them and then really ask, depending on how much pushing and pulling goes on at the boundaries, what happens to the position of the centrosomes. And then we find that if you put no motors, then the centrosomes, they will find the middle of the cell initially. But when the filaments become very long and when they buckle, they eventually destabilize this situation. So pushing is an efficient mechanism when the filaments do not buckle, and that means they should not be too long or the cells should not be too large, and they should switch often enough to growing and shrinking to a shrinking state such that they never grow long enough to curl around the thing. So for certain parameter settings, pushing will put this thing in the middle, but it's quite unstable as soon as the microtubules become long. Whereas if you put motors on the side, you get these experiments where all of them are now under tension, just as in the previous experiments. And at least in this geometry, we more or less always get them to be positioned in the middle of the cell. So apparently, For these long filaments, pulling is a more precise, or at least you need a bit of pulling to get this positioning precisely in the middle. And that was not immediately sort of intuitive to us that that would be the case, because if you think about it, if we thought about it first in the simpler fission yeast geometry, if I just model this system very naively in a one-dimensional array, I could take an organizing center and it will nucleate microtubules in both directions. And here I draw it in the middle, but let's say it's not really sitting in the middle yet. And each of these filaments are dynamic, which means that they switch between growing and shrinking states. You can calculate a length distribution of these filaments, and you will convince yourself that they're typically more short ones than long ones. So if you put the thing away from the middle, you get more contact on average with this barrier than with the other barrier. And if these filaments are pushing, that's good, because on average you push it more in that direction than in that direction, and the balance will be in the middle. Whereas if you put a pulling force at the end of these filaments, as soon as you're close to one barrier, you get more pulling forces generated, more contacts. So you would think you always get it away from the center. So we were a bit surprised, not by this experiment, that pushing would put it in the middle. And this, of course, doesn't take into account the buckling. But naively, at least in this geometry, we expected that whenever a centrosome would move close to one edge, it would create more contact and it would be destabilized. And that's not what's happening. Yeah.
Just in this case of grinding, do you really quite specific tubing concentration?
Yeah, so you have to be, what you have to tune is the length of the filaments compared to the size of the chamber. And that depends, the length of the filaments depends on how fast they grow and how often they switch. And this can be tuned with the tubulin concentration and the temperature. So you, we go, it's typical numbers, you go to 25, 30 degrees and high enough concentrations to make this happen. If the filaments are very short, and then the behavior is different. I didn't bring those movies, but this is what I'm showing you are the results for a condition where the microtubules are long compared to the size of the system. That's when you get this result. Other questions? Okay, so and just so sort of this picture, I hope it was clear, sort of gave us the intuition that, you know, if it's pushing, it should go to the center, and if it's pulling, which means you pull it in this direction, it should not go to the center. And at best, if all of the filaments reach all sides, so you get equal forces on both ends, it would just stay where it is, but never would it go to the center. And the reason it does happen is really a geometrical one. So we got together with Frank Jülicher, a theoretical physicist, biophysicist in Dresden, and he is, together with people in his group, Rui Mein and Ad Bavin, made a mechanical model of this problem, taking into account the dynamics of the filaments, the shape of the confinement, the probability of being captured by a motor protein at the site, and then quickly realized why it is that in this particular geometry, this argument doesn't hold, and you actually do get a force that brings this system to the middle. So I'm just showing you the cartoon version of sort of how we now understand why this works. So now let's first assume a little bit like I did here, but for the 1D case, but now for the 2D case, put the centrosome here somewhere, and then I allow all the filaments to become long enough to reach the edges. And this is where it matters that they all should be long. So if the filaments are very short, the arguments are different. But if they reach all sides and nothing else happens, you put an equal pulling force on all ends, then at best, this thing doesn't know where it goes because you add up all the forces in all directions and the net zero force is zero, just like I was drawing over here. But in reality, in the experiments, and the filaments don't immediately hook up to a pulling force generator. So they reach the cell boundary or the chamber boundary, and this is a bit exaggerated in this drawing, but we see it also in the experiments, the filaments slide a little bit before they hook up to a motor. So by the time they hook up to a motor protein, they're no longer isotropically distributed along this centrosome. And you now put an equal force on all ends, and the net resulting force always puts you towards the center. So no matter where you put this thing, as long as you assume an isotropic distribution of filaments, and you assume that they reach all boundaries, then the net sort of the net force is always pointing towards the center of this chamber. And that's what we see happening in the experiments. And you can actually measure the anisotropy and the filament distribution in our chambers. It's not very strong, but it's there, and it's enough to always bring this thing to the center and nowhere else. Yeah. You mean a donut or a circular confinement? Yeah, so this, we did the square because our chambers were square. We're now doing this in microfluidic droplets, and I have about 10 minutes left to show you that. But in a spherical geometry, exact same effect, 3D geometry, it's even stronger. The only geometry in which it doesn't work is the 1D geometry that I was drawing here. So now we like to think, okay, that's why yeast doesn't use pulling forces to position, because it cannot if it's an elongated cell. And what we cannot do easily in the experiments, but what we can do in the theory, is to sort of systematically change the parameters. And it's going back to the discussion we just had. So in this plot, there's two parameters that are varied. One is the catastrophe rate. So it's the rate at which they grow switch. And if you have a very high catastrophe rate, then the filaments on average are very short. And if the filaments are very short, then this argument also works in a 3D or a 2D geometry. The filaments are very short. You get unstable positioning due to pooling, because you always go to where the most of the contacts are. And the other parameter here is how likely you are to find a motor protein at the wall, basically the attachment rate. So if you have short filaments and a lot of motors, you get pooling and it's unstable. If you have a lot of motors but very long filaments, then pooling is stable because of the effect I just demonstrated to you. If you have no motors or very few, then you need pushing to have stable positioning. But it now only works for relatively short microtubules, because if you have very long ones, you get this bending behavior. And again, it's unstable. So it really shows that in this 2D but also 3D geometry, depending on how many motors you have and how long the filaments are, you can get different kinds of behaviors. And it's really consistent what we find in the experiments. And that's, you know, the nice thing about the simple experiments we do is that we can compare them with these theories. Whether then this is also how it happens in a real cell, which is what motivates us in the beginning, is not sure, because there are many other things are happening at the same time. But at least we show that this is how it could work also in the cell. So I have 5 more minutes, 10 more minutes, 3 more minutes. Just to tell you where we are now, because it's all relatively old. So that, you know, that's nice, but we were interested in this spindle. And we so far had just a single ester in a square chamber. So we try now to get a bit more to realistic conditions for cells. Biologists tell us, you know, cells are not square and flat, although they're sometimes flat. And how about, for example, taking spherical geometries, as you were just asking. So we switched from these chambers to microfluidic droplets. It's also much easier to do, it turns out. And we do like many people do. Actually, the first time we did it, we came to Paris here and to Patrick Trebling's group, and he taught us how to do this. And we used the pressure machine to push oil and water through a PDMS device that was developed also here by Jean-Louis Viovi. He's selling them. And this device allows you to put a very constant pressure on a series of channels where we put in oil. And in this blow-up of this part of the chip, oil comes from the sides with lipids. And from the left, we push in water. And this contains the tubulin and the centrosomes, whatever we want to put in. And then you create droplets of about 10, 15 microns in diameter again. But it's again hard confinement. These are emulsion droplets. So it's just a monolayer of lipids that forms around the water. has a very high surface tension, so it's like a really like a hard container. It doesn't deform easily at all, and then we can sort of do the same experiments, but now in a 3D spherical geometry instead of a flat square one. And we hook up the molecular motors now to the lipids by using a biotinylated lipid and biotinylated dynein molecule, still the same ones. So we can adapt the model, and Frank did that, or Ruima did that in his group, to a three-dimensional geometry, and just repeat what we did in the past and show I'll show you both with and without the motors where the centrosome goes if you do not have any motors, and then this pushing as unstable behavior due to long bending microtubule is even more pronounced. So with long filaments, no motors, we always find the centrosomes here at the side. This is the statistics, the distance from the middle, this is sort of the radius one, that's where you find it at the edge of the droplet, whereas if you put motors on the edge, it pulls them very nicely to the center, and you get this kind of distribution. It's never enormously strong statistics, but it's a very clear difference in behavior, where it sits either in the center if motors are there, and it doesn't. It sits on the edge when motors are not there. And we can look at two centrosomes, so this just being able to look at two centrosomes is simply due to the fact that we have slightly bigger volumes and we have slightly higher concentrations of centrosomes. So we find a reasonable number of droplets that have two centrosomes. And now if you have no motors, they sit both on the edges. They repel each other, so nothing else is there, but just a steric interaction between these filaments, these brushes, if you want, pushes them apart. And it's a kind of a calculation you can do to make an estimate of how large that force is. So now the question is, if we have both a cortical force pulling this thing to the middle and a repulsive force between the two centrosomes, what's the end result of that? And you fairly easily get a steady state result where the two centrosomes sit at a fixed distance from each other, which is smaller than the diameter of the droplet. So without doing anything else, no relevant associated proteins there yet, you already get quite robustly a mitotic spindle type organization just by balancing the forces at the cortex that are pulling these things to the middle with the repulsive force between the esters. And we can now, what we do now is use this sort of as a platform, because there's many molecules, and I'm just listing here different types of them that you can find in reviews about the mitotic spindle. Many associated molecules that are known to be very important for a proper organization of the spindle. Known meaning if you take them out of a cell, then the spindle doesn't organize at all. So you start to wonder, okay, why is that? Because if I put nothing, I get a spindle-like organization. Is that an accident? And how is this force balance affected or not by adding additional molecules? So you can think of the chromosomes themselves. That would be nice one day, but we don't add them yet. Or molecules that connect the microtubules here in the middle to each other. So there's molecular motors, passive cross-linkers that are all sitting here in the middle and believed to be important for a proper organization. And we start adding them to these experiments. So far, we've added a passive cross-linker called ACE1. So it will look for anti-parallel microtubules and cross-link them. This one comes from yeast. And a kinesin 5, which is an anti-parallel motor cross-linker. It's the same as EGG5, if you know about these systems. Very important for proper spindle organization. And we can add that to our system and then sort of observe the different phenotypes that you get. And this is just showing some examples of that, in this case, we didn't put any motors on the side, but just growing filaments, and they sit at a distance that is very far, as I showed you. But then if you put a bit of ACE1, it will put an attractive force between these two centrosomes, because ACE1 is trying to maximize the overlap between the filaments. So that's interesting. Instead of putting motors on the edges, you can also put an anti-parallel passive crosslinker in the middle to pull them together. Completely different mechanism, but same phenotype, if you like. Unless you put too much, and then they get too close together and the whole thing destabilizes again. But that you can then counterbalance again with adding EGG5, which will now, in the presence of this high concentration of ACE1, push everything apart again. So you know, we're now in a situation that with a very small number of components, we get a spindle-like structure, and we really can start to play with what is the effect of addition of individual or combinations of molecules, and that's what we're doing. And it's a bit the reverse of what you do in a cell, where you take each of these individual components out and then look what happens and try to infer what the contribution of that molecule was. And even in these very simple experiments, we show that that can be very difficult to interpret, actually, because if you assume like this is a phenotype that doesn't have a good organization of the spindle, sorry, I'm going to go one more further. There's actually different molecular mechanisms that can put you back in a correct situation. So you could simply add ACE1, forget about this stuff here at the top, and you get into a good separation. But you could also put dynein at the cortex, you get a good separation, or you could make the microtubules shorter and you also get into a good separation. So very different mechanisms leading to the same phenotype. And if you combine the two, it's very difficult to interpret exactly what's going on. Sort of, again, emphasizing how really difficult that is if you do it top-down in a real cell. Of course, it all has to be done, but it's just interesting to see how you don't need much to make this already complex. Okay, how about the future? So what are our dreams? I'm showing you mostly static pictures. So one of the things we would like to do is really to follow the dynamics of these positioning processes. So we can now actually do this, this is just the first tries where we have during 2 hours really 2 minute intervals of this position, and before just technical problems with bleaching why we couldn't do that, but we can do that now. And we would really like to do asymmetric positioning, so I didn't emphasize it, but the C. elegans spindle actually doesn't position in the middle, it positions a little bit off to one side, to the right side here. And that is believed to be due to an enhanced concentration of molecular motors on one side of this embryo. So we're trying now to make, using microfluidic devices, droplets that really have the shape of C. elegans. So they're elongated with the aspect ratio that is correct for C. elegans embryo. So this is now an embryo, and this is one of our droplets, all to the same scale. And we want to now recruit dynein molecular motors preferentially at one end of these droplets to see if we can watch this asymmetric positioning happen. And the technique that we are developing for that is these opto-control techniques, where you have heterodimer systems that will attach to each other in the presence of light. It's this Love domain, so we want to put this Love domain on the on the lipid monolayer and then shine light to recruit dynein specifically on one end. And for the moment, that works on a surface, so you can put all this stuff on a surface and show that you recruit molecules in the presence of light, but it's not really working yet inside the droplets, again, for technical reasons that we have to solve. And once we have that working, that's what we will do, recruit molecules here in the droplets, although one problem we foresee is that this diffusion of the lipids will actually kill this whole experiment, which means that we may need to go back to the chambers again. After all, hopefully not. So I'll stop here and thank the many people we collaborate with and you for your attention.